Welcome, everybody, to Your Purpose Podcast. And today we have April, and we're going to hear so much more about her and her ministry and all that she's doing. And you're going to absolutely love it. It has a lot to do with family and children and everything. And there's an upcoming event. But I want to start with God's Word. And so we're going to be in Matthew chapter 19, and I'm going to read verses 13 through 15. I'm using the NLT. One day, some parents brought their children to Jesus so he could lay his hands on them and pray for them. But the disciples scolded the parents for bothering him. But Jesus said, "Let the children come to me. Don't stop them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are like these children." And he placed his hands on their heads and bless them before he left. So good. All right, Father God, I just pray that you are in this conversation with April and may it give you glory. And we just want to highlight family and children in this conversation because they are so critical. And I know that you love them dearly. The word shows that. So dear God, please be in this conversation. Holy Spirit, give us wisdom and guidance as we talk about your word and your kingdom come. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Woo! All right, April. So we met in Colorado. We're taking a class together, and I heard a little bit about her ministry, and I know she has an event coming up, and I think it's like in a week and a half or something, but it's an extremely important one. So I wanted to get her on here so that she can chat about that, encourage you all, and hopefully you're going to attend it because it is very important, and that she has another event coming up in October. So April, I'm just so excited for you to tell us about your ministry. And so how would you like to start off? So I'm just handing it over to you.
Amazing. Amazing. First of all, I want to be clear. It's not my ministry. I get to be a part of it.
There you go.
Yes, it's the Lord's. And also I'm not even the founder. I'm just a part of what this is a movement, even more than a ministry. It is, it's called Her Voice Movement. That's how it originally started. Okay. And now the Lord has us focusing, like you said, on kids in this hour. Yeah. This is an hour that we have to stand up for kids. And so that is what we're doing. If you can see my shirt, it says, "Don't mess with our kids." Yeah, and that is our hashtag. And that is really our vision in this season is saying back off to the enemy, to the agenda, to everyone who is coming after kids in this hour. So that's where I'd like to start, if that's okay. So we believe first and foremost that it is prayer. It is prayer that's going to change this nation. That is the foundation. We are first and foremost a prayer movement.
Okay.
And so we are all about prayer and intercession. And in fact, the back of our t-shirt, which you can't see, says pray, fast, stand. Okay. So we believe that God is actually calling people to prayer first and foremost, to fasting. And that is actually what is going to transform our nation. But the reality is we can't just stay in the church for too long. The church has really relinquished responsibility of going to the public square. And the Bible is actually very clear. There's many times in the Bible it says, go into the public square, take a stand in the public square. And we have actually said, oh, we don't want to get involved in politics and we just want to stand back. But the problem is, I mean, is life politics? Yeah. Is, you know, standing up for life, standing up for purity, standing up for marriage, is that politics or is that the church? It's almost like politics has come into the church and we're backing up even further from that instead of going to the front lines and saying, no, we're going to stand for what the Bible says.
So it's kind of like reverse now, because in the beginning we were founded on God's word. But yeah, now it's kind of like shifted, unfortunately. So I hear you there. That's a terrible situation. So go ahead. Yeah, I love it.
We're in trouble as a nation. Yes. We are in trouble. If God does not come through and rescue us, we're in big trouble. And I just, if I can, just want to talk a little bit about the crisis that we're in. We, you know, a lot of Christians don't actually believe that we're in as much of a crisis as we are. But the reality is we're in a major, major crisis in our nation, and it's going to take the hand of God to rescue us out of this. I don't know if our listeners know this, but the LGBTQ agenda that has been literally, it's shoving the agenda down our children's throats to the extent. It's having massive, massive repercussions.
Right.
And what's happening is that we are seeing huge upward trends of the LGBTQ. Right. It's working. What they're doing, their agenda is working. When, you know, a few years ago, 1 in 100 would young people would identify as LGBTQ.
Right.
As of July, it was 1 in 5.
Oh no, that is
Okay. But now get this. As of last month, it was 1 in 3.
What?
Yes.
That's horrible.
Yes. So
1 in 3?
1 in 3, especially women, interestingly, especially girls. And so 1 in 3, Gen Z specifically, I self-identify as LGBTQ now in this day and age. And I think the shock from July to now, I mean, it was actually in January or February. So 6 months essentially. And, you know, this has been such an aggressive agenda. It is literally going after our kids. But why would they go after our kids? You know, like, they're not voters, right? Like, but if you look at history, if we look at Hitler, if we look at Stalin, if we look at people throughout history that have wanted to change the course and direction of a nation, they went after the kids. Hitler said, I don't really care if you're not on my side. I have your children.
Well, and then that kind of brings back to remembrance of, like, with Moses and how all of those children were killed, right? And then he was put in a basket and saved, you know, thank God. But, and that, I mean, even when Jesus was born, right, all those children were killed. Yeah, and now we're in this also with the abortion, how so many kids are killed. Sex trafficking, kids are molested and killed. And it's like, but they're like with Moses and with Jesus. So it kind of makes me think too, like, there's so much more we don't fully understand, obviously, but yes.
The enemy is scared, Leslie. The enemy is scared because he knows his time is short, and we are in a season of deliverers. We are in a season where God is actually raising up not one deliverer, but many deliverers, right? Are being raised up and will deliver a nation. I really believe that. And you're exactly right. The enemy is going after the children for that. For that, because he hates us. He hates us because we're made in the image of God. And that brings us back to the whole identity crisis in our nation, because if we're made in the image of God, God didn't make a mistake. He didn't make a girl a boy on accident, right?
I know.
And so the whole idea is to actually mar the face of God.
Okay.
The enemy's agenda is so much bigger than just, oh, I'm going to get these kids confused.
Yeah.
But he's actually after marring the character, the nature, and the face of the creator.
Which he did started in the garden. I mean, it's always twisting things and
Absolutely. Absolutely. So he has a very specific agenda, and he is definitely coming after our kids. I mean, we have slides, we have so much information that communicates what the enemy is actually after is our children. He is going into the schools. I don't know if our listeners realize this, but there's actually pornography in our schools.
What? That's what I was going to ask you. Are you able to go into the schools at all? Or what is your relationship with the schools? How's that going?
So there are many people in it that are connected with us that are going into schools. Because it's actually not the school itself that can make the decision. It's the school board.
The school board. Okay.
Yes. And there are many, not even only through our ministry, but a lot of different organizations that are trying to get into school boards and standing up. Anyone can actually go to a school board meeting. This is what we found out, is when you show up, darkness actually gives way.
So I never even thought about that. Thank you for mentioning that. It's like, why are we going to school boards? And why are we hearing? Why didn't I even think of that? That's so powerful. Why aren't we doing that? Like I said, but I didn't even think about it. So that is amazing.
Because we've told the church to stay in the church. We've told the church that your role is stay in the church. You're allowed to go out and witness to people, but that's like your role. It's like the limit of where you can leave the church. Mm. And that is not the truth. That's never going to change the seven mountains of influence. We have to actually infiltrate the mountain to influence the mountain, right? And so the school boards is an excellent way to get involved. I'll tell you,
I love that.
That what happened in our community near our there yeah. was a video that went viral of a girl in junior high who was getting beat up by a transgender boy.
Okay.
And this, you know, some kid like caught it on video, and this mama bear found out about it. And
because it was her, was it her child or not that was getting beat up?
It was her daughter, and she found out. And instead of squelching it, she decided, you know what? Everybody needs to know what is happening in our schools. And this was not the first time that there was like a group of transgender boys that were going around beating up girls. And so they made that video go viral. She sent it out to influencers and it went all over the nation. Okay. And this was in our little like suburb.
Oh, it was? So it was close to home. Oh, okay. Yeah.
And you know what? We're like, you know, we're going to do something about this. We're going to go to the school board meeting when they talk about this. And so we started spreading the word, getting our congregation to know about it. We wore our t-shirts and we show up, and you know, the school board found out that there was going to be a lot of community people. So they decided to go on Zoom. They did not.
Oh, they did the chickens.
They would not.
Scared. That's what Satan's that he, Satan is really a loser and he is a chicken. That's man.
But what's amazing, Leslie, is that so many people showed up for this. Yeah. It wasn't just us. We found out there were people from the media that were there. There were gays against groomers. So there are people even on the other side, so to speak, that are recognizing that they're grooming our children and that it's wrong. And so they were there. There were lots of people from the community that showed up to support this mom. And when we got there, we're like, oh, wow, there's 200 people here. And so we're like, we're just going to go over here and pray. And I'm
praying.
And we'll just be over here in our little corner, because that's what we do in the church, right? We're just going to go over here and we're just going to do our thing.
Okay.
And you do your thing and we'll do our thing and it'll be great. Well, the media came over and they said, hey, who are you guys? You know, we're all on our team. And they're like, oh, you're going to pray? Why don't you come over here and pray on the microphone? So it ended up being we got to share the gospel. We got to take communion. We led
Hallelujah.
The people. Communion. It was amazing. But what we found out is that when light shows up, darkness gives way.
Oh, I love it.
They literally were like, come, come. They allowed us to take center stage and really organize. I mean, literally we took over the meeting because it was like, okay, here is what we're fighting for. This is actually what.
But that was outside, because you said they went to Zoom, right? So the meeting going on?
It ended up being a spontaneous meeting at the exact same time.
Okay, it's the exact same.
People that came to protest what was happening in the school.
Oh, wow. So that's so powerful. So God is always able to make good from bad, of course. So he took that bad situation and turned it for his glory. Hallelujah. Oh,
yes,
that is so good.
An example, we're going to city council meetings. We're showing up at things because we're, you know, the LGBTQ community is showing, they're showing up big. They're going to them. They have been, you know, for years. And the church is kind of just catching up, right?
Yeah. I'm like, I didn't even think about it. Duh. But so I'm so glad we're having this conversation, because if I didn't think about it, I'm guessing somebody else didn't think about it too.
Absolutely. It is kind of unheard of, but it's time. Time to take our stand in the public square.
For sure.
And we're actually seeing that when we stand up and when we take a stand, the enemy gives way, and we're starting to even the LGBTQ community is even like questioning, like, who are these people? What's going on? We were at a city council meeting 2 weeks ago.
Okay.
And we were told, because it ended up being all of us in our pink and blue on one side.
Okay.
We have a flag too. And all of the LGBTQ on the other side. And so the mayor was like, can we talk to each other? And it was a lovely mayor. And we were actually there to support the mayor in that situation, because he was taking it. And so we actually got to meet the LGBTQ people that were there to stand up for their rights. And we just looked and we said, we're going to look them in the eye and we're going to love them. you know,
yeah, we love them. That's not the issue.
We're not their enemy, you know. Right. We're actually not mad at them. No. We're mad at the enemy for what he's done to them. So it was really beautiful. We actually, one of our people is like meeting for coffee with their president. And I mean, God is going to do something amazing through that situation.
He is so good. And I love too, where you don't have that shirt on too, but don't you have a shirt that says silence isn't safe? Yes. So if people are going, well, I don't know that I want to say anything. I'm just going to sit back and pray quietly in my little corner, which I'm not saying that's bad. You want to pray, but do you really want to be silent out in the community? Because yes, silence isn't safe. Yes, prayer is super powerful. Intercession is very, very powerful, but I do feel like we still need to say something.
Well, it is the decade of the pay, right? It's a decade of the mouth. And so I believe that's God saying it is time, church, to speak up. You know, the whole idea of silence isn't safe. It comes from the book of Esther. And when Esther was in her palace, and remember Mordecai came out mourning and speaking in the streets. And Esther was like, whoa, like send him some nice clean clothes. And, you know,
wash up, look good.
Yes. And Mordecai says to her, listen, do not think that it is okay for you. Don't think that you're safe being silent, essentially. Right. Don't think that you in your palace is safe. See, the thing is, Leslie, I don't know about where you're from, but where I'm from in Oregon's kind of crazy, you know? We are the liberal, right? We're like one of the most unchurched.
Really? Okay.
I mean, Portland, Oregon, actually during the whole BLM and Antifa and all of the rioting, we had 102 days straight of riots downtown.
That's a long time.
It's a long time, just destroying our city.
Over 3 months. Wow.
And
okay.
Essentially, it was like the church was waiting for evil to give up. You know,
just wear them out.
Right. Evil just doesn't do that. So that's one of the reasons, you know, our leader, Pastor Jenny Donnelly, she said to the Lord, God, what is it going to take for the church to stand up in this hour? And Leslie, what God told her shook us all to the core. And he said, when they take your kids.
Is that just horrific? I mean, can you imagine? And thank God that I can't literally imagine this, someone taking that sex trafficking. I mean, they lure children away. There's so many things that are going on to our children, you know, that you don't, like I said, haven't experienced. And like I said, seriously, that's amazing. But can you feel for these people that are going through these things, that the demonic is attacking their children? And I mean, my children are all grown. They're, you know, I don't even have any children left at home, but it's like, I can't even imagine. I know, that's what I mean. It's just, yes, I have a family and I can't even imagine. Like I said, praise God that my family is safe at the moment, right? But I mean, tomorrow's a new day, unfortunately.
That's the thing, Leslie, is that is what we think of. When we think of them taking our children, we think of sex trafficking, which is real and a crisis, but it feels far away from home. What we're starting to see is that their child protective services is actually coming into homes of Christians and taking their kids because they will not affirm their gender transition.
What? Hey, can you give me more information on that? Because I don't understand that. What?
Yes. So basically the agenda that is so aggressively infiltrating our schools is also infiltrating other areas. And we have friends who literally, we know of people who are connected with people that CPS has come into their home and said, you're not confirming their gender transition. And therefore you're not being a good parent. You're not fit to parent, and kids are being taken out of homes. This is what the news is not telling us. They are coming after our kids, and it's not far away. It's literally next door. We're talking about Montana, Texas, Idaho. It's not. So this is what I was saying, is that people in Oregon think, I'm going to run to Idaho. I'm going to run to Montana and I'll be safe there. Well, we're not safe there. It's not safe in any state. It's like saying my kitchen's on fire, I'm going to run to the bedroom. Like, we have to face the fire and we have to put it out, right? We can't just run to another state and think that's a conservative state, I'm going to be safe there, because this agenda is so aggressive. And it's all part of the, you know, I hate to say it, but like the socialism agenda, and it's all connected to money. It's always about money.
Money, right. They idolize, that's their idol, right? Instead of idolizing and worshiping God, they've got their eyes on money. Wow. Yes. That is just so horrific to even think about, that if my child or my grandchild is confused for whatever reason, and my granddaughter thinks she's a boy, you know, and then in some states, the city feels they have the right to come and take that child out of that home.
And the schools is actually how they're accessing the kids.
Oh, the school. Okay.
If a child at school says, oh, I'd like to identify as a boy, they're actually calling parents barriers. They're calling parents unsafe. They're saying that often parents don't understand your transition. And so they will, I've read stories about, they're literally giving girls binders. So, and they can identify at school as a boy, and then they take them off when they go home. They have changes of clothes at school so that they can identify how they want to at school.
That's crazy. And then aren't they like encouraging even like sex changes, like operations?
Yep. Which are permanent. We like, think about the long-term effects, you know, in 50 years from now, these kids are going to come to us and say, why didn't you stand up for me?
Right. Yeah. I can't have children now. Why didn't you stand up for me? Cause I have heard of that, where people have had sex changes, or children have had sex changes. And then even a year or two later, they're like, what just happened? I was confused at that time, but now I can't go back. And it's like, I have heard of, you know, something like that. That's just.
Absolutely. It's happening all over. And, you know, part of the problem is it's not just like our kids arbitrarily deciding they want to be a boy, right? Like the agenda is coming in through cartoons. It's coming in through every time you turn on the TV, every time you look at Instagram. I mean, it's just unbelievable. It's everywhere. But we have a friend, her name is Erin Lee, and she is with Rights from Parents out of Colorado.
Okay.
And she actually, her daughter was 12 years old, and she asked to go to art club. And her mom said, of course you can go to art club, you know?
Right.
And she calls herself just a nominal Christian at that point. And she said, you know, she was just not really discerning. And she was like, yeah, go to art club. And she got to art club and found out it was actually gender, confusion. Let's call it gender confusion club.
Yes, sure. But
essentially they got them around, and they told them, if you are uncomfortable at all in your body, then you're actually trans. Because you don't know what you are. And I'm sorry, but what 12-year-old little girl doesn't it feel uncomfortable sometimes, or a little
and the puberty?
Boy.
Well, yeah, you've got that puberty, the and hormones are in a transition
in their body at 12 years old. Anyway, so she came home after I think it was an hour and a half or 2 hours of art club, and told her mom she was trans. She had a trans flag. She came into the car like a different person, under the spell. Let's be honest, it is a demonic spell.
And see, that's the thing most people don't understand, that we are fighting against, well, Ephesians 6 in the Bible, we are fighting against the principalities. But the thing is, most people don't understand that we are fighting against Satan and his demons and the principalities. And I think that's part of the problem, is they think it's just like a little earthly, fleshly thing, and you're fighting against people. It's way beyond that. It's way beyond that. Absolutely. But like I said, they need to read the Bible. And that's the other thing. Most people aren't educated about God's word, which is full of truth and talks about the demonic and how we need to fight against the spirit of principalities and all that. So sorry, I just had to jump in there, because I'm like, it's not the flesh we're really fighting.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right, Leslie. If you've ever read the book, Jonathan Kahn wrote a book called Return to Gods.
I actually have it on my shelf right over there. Yes, I love that book. I have that book. I have it. It's good.
It's so good. And it really helps people understand what we're fighting here. This is 100% not an earthly battle. This is the heavenly battle. Yes. But we also have to go into the streets and take a stand in the natural. It's like we have and we have a ground game, right?
Yes. Like, both. Well, right. We're fighting on both fronts.
It all depends on God, and we work as if it depends on us, right? We have the air game and the ground game. And our air game, we actually have prayer hubs. We've started all over the nation.
The prayer hubs, then, so do they pray and then go out? So do on both levels.
That's the goal, is that they would do both. We have, so our prayer hubs is any, honestly, we're really encouraging families. Anyone who has a kids, you have a prayer hub. Like, get your kids, get your family, get your husband, get your kids, get your neighbor, anyone around you. And we are asking 1 hour once a month. Now, that's not very much, right?
That's not very much.
That's minimal. Okay. And we actually give you even what to pray. We give you
30. So you do. That's what I was going to ask you, because people are kind of intimidated sometimes. They're like, I kind of want to do this. I'm a little scared. I don't know how it works. I don't know what to pray. So maybe tell us a little bit more about that. Cause I, hopefully somebody on this is, you know, this podcast they're hearing, they're like, I'm scared, but I want to help, but I'm scared. How can you encourage them to dig in more?
Absolutely. And that is the beauty of this, is that it is so simple. Okay. And we have these 30 points that you pray. You can actually read them. They're written in prayer form. You can read them off. So you can go to hervoicemovement.com and find prayer hubs. And all the resources are there. What's really cool, Leslie, is we even have kids versions. So we have it in more kid-friendly language. And then coloring sheets for littles, so that we do every single month, we put out new coloring sheets.
I love that.
So what we do is we literally have, you know, all the adults, all the kids, all the people, and we put the coloring sheets in the middle and the kids are coloring and everyone's praying. We invite them into the process because what happens a lot of times is we put the kids off in the corner and we adults pray, you know, but just like the verse you read in Matthew 18, right? Was it 18?
Matthew 19, yes.
19, thank you. About we have to bring the kids to Jesus. We have to, because what is it? If we change a nation and we don't teach our kids how it changed, right? We have to bring them into the process. And I know my kids, I have a Gen Z, and I have two Gen Z actually, and one Gen Alpha, and they're learning how to pray. They're learning how to prophesy. They're learning how to declare over their nation. And and it's beautiful.
That's awesome. And they can get all this resources just by going to your website, and download it for free. It's all free.
Yeah, it's amazing. And we're believing, you know, Lou Engle, I don't know if you know him, but he has been championing this as well. He is 100% running with us because, okay, so here is the breakdown. April 13th is when we're standing, which is literally a week and a half from today. So April 13th, we are going to every capital in the nation, including Washington, D.C. So every single capital will have a gathering. So wherever you're listening to this, you can go April 13th from 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock.
Okay, 1 to 3. Okay, so show it from 1 to 3. And then, so what happens when they show up?
We're going to have some worship. We're going to have some prayer. We're going to take communion. We're going to do repentance for our nation.
Okay.
We're going to talk about how we can get involved and what you can do to take a stand. We're talking about, it's revival unto reformation, right?
Okay.
Because this is crazy, Leslie. Think about this. Okay. That in the Jesus movement, when all of the hippies were getting saved and it was incredible move of God, right? We all watched the Jesus Revolution.
I saw it a couple times, even three. Yeah. Yes.
So amazing. And we honor the fathers of that movement. But the problem was they went into the church and they did not go outside of the church. Everyone started cutting off the world, cutting off everything around the world. We started to have our own music and our own everything, right? But what happened is the most egregious abortion law, Roe v. Wade, was passed
hiding in the church.
Yes, during the Jesus movement.
Oh.
So while revival's going on in the church, we've abdicated our responsibility in the world, and we've let the world make the decisions.
And that's why we're not supposed to be silent. Don't be silent.
We pay dearly for that. And so what we're saying is revival unto reformation. We have to have both. We have to go into public square. So that is why we are taking a stand at our state capitals. Yeah. And I believe supernaturally, I actually believe that there's going to be gates that open up in the spirit. I believe that I believe there's something so strategic. To our knowledge, this has never happened before, that every state at the same time, there is a prayer gathering in every capital. Like, that's amazing. And we have, I mean, some of them are going to have hundreds show up. Some of them are going to have smaller groups show up. Some of them, I mean, we're believing for, you know, thousands in Oregon, California, and Washington. So we just know that it's time for the church to take a stand and unify, you know, the enemy. Very unified.
Right. He tries to get everybody like, hiding in their homes. Don't be hiding in your homes. Right. So do they have to register for that or do they just show up?
It would be great if you would register, but if you didn't register, you could still show up.
Okay.
Also, yes. On don'tmesswithourkids.us. How you register. So don'tmesswithourkids.us. And again, that's April 13th. And that is actually unto October 12th. So October 12th, you mentioned in the beginning, there's a great big gathering happening October 12th on the mall at Washington, D.C.
So and it's only at the Washington, D.C. So that one in October is not at the individual state capitals.
Yes. However, we are also seeing no family left behind. So we're going to live stream it. So if someone is not able to get to Washington, we're encouraging you to gather as many people as you can in your home, in your church, in whatever group you have, because we're believing that on one day, which is actually, this is so the Lord, is the Day of Atonement. October 12th, the Day of Atonement, the day when we repent of our sin and we cry out for mercy from the Lord. And it is... The timing of it is so critical. The Lord just organized it all just to get us the permit even. And we're believing for a million women and their families.
And their families.
Sisters, a million Mordecais and millions of kids to intercede for this nation at the same time. And there are so many organizations that are coming together to make this happen because it is time. It is time for the church to unify. It is time for us to cry out as one voice, like it talks about in Joel, that we would lift up our voice and sound the alarm. It's time to repent and ask for mercy for America.
Now that's a different website though, right? So do they go to amillionwomen.org for that one, for that second one? And then through there is that where they would see the live stream if they can't make it to Washington, D.C.? They would go to that website, amillionwomen.org, and then they would be able to watch it through that website. Is that how it works?
Yes. Any of our, so Don't Mess With Our Kids, Her Voice, or A Million, we're all connected. So any of those will give you links to what you need access to. So the prayer hubs, or April 13th or October 12th.
So they're all intertwined and supporting each other. And so I will down in the comments, I will list all of those websites as well as that book that you referenced that's on my shelf over there. So I will, put that on there as well. So is there any final thoughts that you want to shout out or any websites or how to contact you or anything that we didn't talk about that we need to make sure we get in here?
Yeah, I will just say that, you know, the LGBT community has had their flag and they've had their colors. And the Lord actually showed our pastor, Jenny, like, we need a flag and colors too. And I know we're short on time, but you can actually go to the don'tmesswithourkids.us and there's a vision tab and you can watch the entire vision with our entire presentation.
Oh, okay.
And is welcome to do that at any time. We actually have live every Monday, but we have it on replay available all the time. But the reality is that we have to stand united. And the ways that the LGBTQ community has shown us that they're united is their colors. And so we have a flag, and our flag is pink and blue because God made female and God made male. And it is very clearly pink and blue, and it says don't mess with our kids. And we're asking women to wear pink and men to wear blue. And you can, you know, you can go on our website and order ours, or you can wear your own. But when you come on April 13th, when you come on April 12th, you know, if you drove by a park and you saw people gathered and they're all in the same color, you take notice. If they're all in just normal street clothes, you're like, oh, what's that? Business meeting. Cool. Like there's no connection with that. We know when we drive by and it's a pride parade, you know, like we know it immediately. And so we're believing that God is actually just going to take these colors and explode it across the nation in a wave of pink and blue, that we we as citizens of the United States, as citizens of heaven, yeah, are saying it is time. God made male, God made female, and the future is male and female. You know, if you think about how the enemy is attacking our future, there is no future without male and female.
Right. Oh yeah. We would all, procreation would stop.
My youngest child, when we first started talking about this, it was about 2 years ago, and really, you know, communicating to him. So he would have been 7 at the time. Okay. And he was like, Mom, that's really dumb. There's no kids. I'm like, yeah, you're right. That's
two men together can't have kids.
Okay, there's no kids. That's what he told me. And I
thought, my husband actually said that last night. Yes. Two men cannot make a child.
Yes. This is science, people. If you want to listen to the silence, science.
I know. Yeah, if the world becomes all homosexual, it will cease to exist, right?
But, yes.
Yeah. So thank you for about the colors. The colors too. I love that. How, make sure you wear your pink for the women and blue for the men on that, you know, when you go to the Capitol coming up here on the 13th, you know, represent your true identity, which God created you to be. So, so amazing. Yeah. And like I said, I'll put a bunch of information down in the comments so they can get a hold of all that free information for the prayer hubs and for the dates and everything. So I thank you so much. Like I said, you've opened my eyes. And that's why I wanted to have this. I'm like, I knew there was more to this. I'm like, but I didn't understand. And I'm like, okay, well, I know the lady that does. And so that's what, thank you so much for helping me. And I pray that it helps other people as they watch this. Mm-hmm. It's such important information for now, for today. We can't just keep silent because we need to have our voice heard and everything. So
absolutely.
All right. Well, I think we're going to close this as much as, you know, we could go talk for hours and days and weeks, but anyways, it's been amazing, April. Thank you so much. God bless you. We'll see you later.
Bye-bye.
Bye.